top of Webster Pass was still there and we couldn't get through. So we looked at it and Dean said, well, you're going to have to back down a long way to get back down to where you can turn around. I said, no problem, I'll just turn right around here. Next thing I know, the door's open and three people are out of the Jeep. So here I just backed up the Jeep up the hill, turned a couple turns and got down. And on the way down, I thought, well, I'll give them a little thrill. And there was a whoop-de-doo in the trail, so I hit that a little harder. And I actually hit it quite hard. And the next thing I knew, the back of the Jeep was up in the air, and it lofted Dean and Ruth right up against the roof. Literally hit the roll bar, the back bar, the top. Fortunately, it was a soft top. When I stopped and looked around, Ruth's glasses were hanging. It looked like they'd been run over by a tank. You know, they still became friends, or stayed friends with us, but never wanted to go sheeping again.
Is there anyone else who'd like to share a memory? Have a special memory that they'd like to share.
My name is Leo Trujillo, and I didn't know Dean for very long, and I didn't know him very well, but I thought a lot of him. And I just found out that he liked railroading. I spent 23 years on the railroad, and I would love to have known that he liked railroading so I could have shared some things with him. I'm looking forward to the day when we can meet in heaven and talk about railroading.
Anyone else have a special memory that they'd like to share?
My name is Danette Robertson Sisson. Uncle Dean is one of his nieces. And we would go at times to visit them and when they lived in Maryland. We'd go from Collegedale, and I was one of the older cousins. And sometimes we would pick on the younger cousins. I can't imagine that we did, but we did. And we might get in trouble, but I always knew that Uncle Dean was over in the corner laughing and cheering us on. And so it was always, you knew you had him in your corner, even if maybe the mothers were getting you in trouble.
Wanted to say that Russ and I were really good friends, Dean and Ruth, and always enjoyed, we even spent some holidays together, and he liked to tease, don't know if he meant to or not, but I had grown up being teased, and so I didn't appreciate it a whole lot, but I did love Dean, Ruth, and we want to stay close to you.
Anyone else have a special memory that they'd like to share? Right, this time I have our scripture.
I'm Stephen the youngest. This is taken from Psalms 91, 1 through 6. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. Surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that lays waste at noonday.
I'm especially impressed with the trains. They're outside in the lobby, and as you have lunch in a little bit, that are on your tables as well. I think that is a really neat touch today for a train enthusiast. You know, as I listened to the stories, I heard of plans to go on trips, and the fun on those trips. I heard of plans to put trains together around Christmas trees, and then fulfilling those plans. Plans to move across the country, plans to go to Europe, plans to visit family. We tend to have a lot of plans in life, don't we? Life is one plan after another. But no one plans on getting sick, do they? Nobody plans on getting older. Nobody plans on aches and pains. I know Dean didn't plan on getting sick. None of us do, right? But I'm so happy to know that in the Bible, God has plans as well. Plans that are better than any of the plans that we can set up in our own lives. Even for the surprises in life that we don't expect or plan for. And although we experience sickness and death here on earth, God has a plan for doing away with some of those things that we have to experience here on earth. In the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 42 to 44, it says, "Our earthly bodies which die and decay are different from the bodies that we shall have when we come back to life again. For they will never die," it says. "The bodies we have now embarrass us," the Bible says. "The bodies we have now embarrass us, for they become sick and die. But they will be full of glory when we come back to life again," the Bible says. Yes, we are weak and dying bodies now. But when we live again, our bodies will be full of strength. They are just human bodies at death, but when they come back to life, this translation of the Bible says they will be superhuman bodies. I like that thought. You see, the Bible says that even though we experience sickness here on earth, even though we experience death and separation for a little while here on earth, the Holy Scriptures, the Word of God, tells us that someday God is going to make everything brand new. And we will have new bodies. And the Bible says that those bodies will never, ever get sick again. Doesn't that sound great? The Bible says our bodies now embarrass us a little bit. But our new bodies, when Jesus comes, are going to be perfect. And there will never be anything more like cancer. No more diabetes. Nothing that will harm our bodies anymore. Jesus says that will be done and over with. And I'm looking forward to that day. I'm so thankful to know that God has a plan for us beyond this life that we live right now, where we experience sickness and death and separation. As you've heard, we make many good memories here in life. We also go through tough times here in life. But God has bigger plans than what we can see right here. And I love that God has plans for us. That shows how much He cares for each one of us. That He has plans beyond what we can even imagine for us. And He went to great lengths to make sure that those plans would become a reality. You know, the Bible talks quite a bit about the topic of death. And inevitably, it happens to all of us, doesn't it? In the very beginning, there was no such thing as death. And then it became something that every human being that is born into this earth experiences. There's a story in the Bible, and I want to just briefly go through that story today, because I think it gives us hope on a day like today. The Bible says in Luke chapter 8, verse 40, says, "So it was when Jesus returned that the multitude welcomed him, for they were all waiting for him. And behold, there was a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue." Jairus was a very important man. And Jairus was also a father to a 12-year-old little girl who he loved dearly with all of his heart. The Bible says that he fell down at Jesus' feet and begged him to come to his house. For he had an only daughter, about 12 years old, the Bible says that she was dying. But as he went, the multitude thronged around, and Jesus in the middle of a big, huge crowd. Everyone is vying for Jesus' attention here. And this father, his heart is just being pulled out of his chest. because he's worried about his daughter. Jumping down to verse 49, the story continues. It says, while he was still speaking, Jesus is talking, and Jairus is now talking again with Jesus. There's the woman who came and touched his robe right in the middle of the story. And as soon as she is healed, Jesus is talking to Jairus. And the Bible says, while he was still speaking, someone came to the ruler of the synagogue, from the ruler of the synagogue's house, and said to him, your daughter is dead. Do not trouble the teacher anymore. Words that no doubt stung that father. Words that caused grief and sadness. Because those are natural feelings when we feel loss and separation from someone that we love. Someone that we've created so many memories with. It's totally natural to feel a little bit of grief and sadness because we've loved that person. We've enjoyed their company. We have memories, 58 sometimes years of memories. And Jairus hears this news, but Jesus also heard this news. Verse 50, it says, but when Jesus heard it, he answered and said, do not be afraid. Over and over in the Bible, Jesus tells us to don't be afraid. In times when we feel fear, anxiety, Jesus is always there saying, you know what? Don't be afraid of this. This is nothing to be afraid of. And that's true. And anything that we experience here on earth that can make us feel anxiety and fear and wonder what's going to happen, Jesus says that same message, don't be afraid. He says, don't be afraid, only believe and she will be made well. When he came to the house, he permitted no one to go in except for Peter, James, and John, the father and mother of the girl. Now all wept and mourned for her. But he said, do not weep, she is not dead, only sleeping, he says. Don't weep, she's not dead, she's only sleeping. And I love that the Bible references death as sleep. Because last night when you went to bed, you closed your eyes, and the next thing you knew, it was morning, right? You didn't know what was going on while you were asleep. Your eyes were closed. You didn't know anything that was going on. It was lights out for a little while. And then morning came, and you opened your eyes to a brand new day. And Jesus, over and over and over in the Bible, calls death asleep. That gives me hope. Death is not forever for someone who believes in Jesus. Death is only a temporary thing, not a permanent thing. He says, she is only sleeping. And it says in verse 53, they ridiculed him knowing that she was dead. They knew more than Jesus did, apparently they thought. Verse 54, but he put them all outside, took her by the hand and called, and I don't picture this in your mind. This is such a beautiful story. He's up there with this little 12-year-old girl. And he says, little girl, arise. Three words. Three words. Similar to his friend Lazarus. Lazarus, come forth. He says, little girl, arise. Then her spirit returned, and she arose immediately. And he commanded that she be given something to eat. And her parents were astonished. The reason this story gives me hope is because it's one of several stories in the Bible where somebody who has passed away is brought back to life. And either this is a lie or it's true, one of the two. Those can only be the two options. And I believe that there are no lies in this book. So I have to believe that that's a true story and that Jesus has the power over death. And that death is only something temporary for a little while. Asleep, he says. Similar with his friend Lazarus. He's at the grave of his friend Lazarus, who's passed and has been 4 days in the grave. And he calls him by name, Lazarus, come forth. And immediately, creative power revives Lazarus. And he comes up out of that grave. and he sees his best friend Jesus and his Savior Jesus. The Bible says that the same thing will happen to those who have fallen asleep in Jesus and who have had that same hope. And Dean had that same hope. Dean had that same belief in a resurrection morning, in a brand new day. I'm so thankful for the portions of Scripture that give us hope when things can seem hopeless. The Bible is sprinkled with verses that give us clarity for days like today. In John 11:25, it says, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. John 5:28-29, it says, do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. The next thing that Dean is going to hear is the voice of Jesus Christ calling him by name, coming from the grave. That's going to be a good day, isn't it? 1 Corinthians 15:51-53. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. I love that verse. And maybe one of the best verses in the Bible for times like this, 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. But we don't want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you will not grieve as others who don't have any hope. Because without the promises in the Bible, the promises from Jesus, it would be a hopeless day today, wouldn't it? If we thought that this was the last goodbye, this would be a rough day, wouldn't it? But Jesus says, I don't want you to grieve as others who have no hope. It's okay to grieve and to miss somebody. It's okay to grieve because you don't get to spend that time daily or get that phone call daily or weekly, because missing someone is totally natural. But on days like today, we don't have to grieve as people who don't have any hope, because Jesus gives us hope in the Bible. It continues, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall always be with the Lord. And on a day when we need comfort like today, it closes and says, therefore, comfort one another with these words. The Bible gives us hope in a better day. It gives us hope in beautiful reunions. Have you ever not seen somebody for a little while, and then you catch up with them and see them, an old friend maybe? And it's someone you've missed terribly, and you see them again, and you give them a big bear hug, maybe a kiss on the cheek, and you catch up on the things that you've missed out on. Resurrection morning is going to be like that, I think. I think it's going to be the best day of your life. Because on days like that, you are going to have some of the most beautiful reunions. And it won't be just 58 years. It'll be 59 years. And then 60 years. And then 500 years. And then 1,000 years. When we get to heaven. Where we'll get to be with the ones that we love. And be with Jesus. There's a verse in 2 Timothy 4:7. And I think it's appropriate for days like today. And someday, at the end of my life, this is a verse that I hope that I can recite and have at the forefront of my mind. It says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. And no doubt, Dean longed for his appearing. And someday, Dean's going to see his Savior's face. He's going to hear his name called by his Creator. And that's going to wake him up from his sleep. Dean is going to be with his Creator and with his family once again. And my friends, today I want to challenge you to do the same in your life and to look forward to that day. I want to challenge you to have that same faith that Dean had. That same faith in a better day, in the second coming of Jesus, in the promises in this book, in the Holy Bible. There's one thing you take away from today. Let it be his example as a Christian man, as a man who lived his life well, as a man who loved Jesus, as a man who dedicated his life to him with the hope in seeing Jesus and you someday, the resurrection morning. I've heard many memories today, seen many pictures, heard many stories, and you wouldn't be here today unless he meant something to you, and you miss him since he's been gone. Don't let anything get in the way of your seeing him again. May we all live our lives with the same faith and integrity and the same hope in Jesus' second coming that Dean did, so that on that morning, nobody's missing. So that on that morning, when God calls Dean's name, and he wakes up from his sleep, and he's looking for you, that you're there to greet him and give him a big bear hug and tell him how much you missed him. May we all live our lives so that we are ready on that day, just as Dean did it today. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, Lord, we're thankful today for the words of hope that you provided us in the Bible. Words that we can hang on to. Words that we can believe in. And Father, even though it may sound too good to be true on days like today, Lord, help us to have the faith to trust your word and to know that your word is true and that there is a better day coming when there will be no more separation, only reunions. So Father, we thank you today that it's only goodbye for a little while, until the day you come back and reunite us. We thank you so much for that hope, God. And keep that hope in the forefront of our minds today. Is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you once again for being here. I want to be sure to invite each one of you to spend a little more time. There's a meal prepared over in the fellowship hall. You are all invited to come and to sit around a table and to share some memories, share a few more stories. Have a nice meal together, catching up. I'm sure there's some of you that haven't seen each other in a while. And reconnect with maybe old friends and family. Thank you so much for coming today and being here. We're going to close with a song. And the song is Under His Wings. And I believe it's going to be up here on the screen. Let's all stand together and sing Under His Wings.
Thank you.
let's keep that in the forefront of our minds, that someday we have a place where we will be with Jesus forever, with the ones that we have missed. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you so much for considering staying for the lunch and connecting with friends and family. God bless each one.